چگونگی تعامل جهان با امارات اسلامی تا هنوز پاسخ روشنی ندارد. کشورهای گوناگون با سیاستهای خودی و عدم توافق کرلی در برابر حکومت کنونی پرداختند. تا این لحظه آمریکا نیز پالیسی مشخص در تعامل با افغانستان ندارد. اما راند، اندیشکده و مرکز تحقیقاتی این کشور سه گزینه را روی میز حکومت آمریکا گذاشته است. تعامل، بهاش راندن و پیکار. و تاکید این اندیشکده بر گزینه تعامل با حکومت افغانستان است. اما پرسش این است که چرا تعامل؟ سلام، وقتتان بخیر. من حامد بهرام هستم. آقای جیمز دابینز، نماینده پیشین آمریکا با افغانستان و پاکستان و حالا کارشناس ارشد و رئیس دیپلماسی و امنیت در اندیشکده راند با ما هستند. مستر جیمز دابینز، فارمر یوس انوای تو افغانستان و پاکستان و سینیر و دیستینگویشت چیر و دیپلماسی و سیکیوریتی در راند کورپوریشن. Thank you so much for joining us, sir.
My pleasure.
You had three options on the table, but you opt to suggest the American government of the engagement option with the Taliban. The question is, why you opted this option?
Well, the three options were engagement, isolation, or opposition. We determined that only the engagement offered the opportunity or the possibility of advancing U.S. interests. Now, we defined U.S. interests as twofold. One was counterterrorism, preventing attacks on the United States originating in Afghanistan. And the other was humanitarian, a desire to try to help the Afghan people preserve at least some of the gains of the last 20 years promote continued economic development and human rights in Afghanistan. We had modest expectations of our ability to influence the Taliban, but we felt we would be more influential if we were talking to them than if we were not.
Do you mean engagement as the recognition of the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan as the legitimate government here in the country?
Well, engagement, if it succeeds, might end up that way, but it wouldn't start that way. It would start with more visits for American officials, for instance. It might move there from there to an interest section in which some other embassy had a section that represented American interests, or a liaison office, which would be an office in Kabul, not lower than an embassy in status, such as we had in Cuba for many years. So there are a number of options, and we would progress up those options as this policy evolved and as it showed some progress. So a lot would depend on how the Taliban responded.
Soren, you have proposed a reopening of the embassy here in Afghanistan. Do you think the situation is conducive to reopen and restart diplomatic mission in Afghanistan?
Well, as I said, we're not proposing to start diplomatic relations or open the embassy. We're proposing to start with more modest steps, such as visits by American officials to Kabul more regularly. And a variety of other means of communication.
The international community has a stance on inclusivity here in Afghanistan. My question is, is Rand too looking for inclusivity here in Afghanistan, if you propose engagement?
Well, yes, I mean, we're proposing that U.S. interests, broadly speaking, as they've already been declared, would be aided by more communication with the Taliban, more regular communication. So we're not recommending any change in policy. We're just recommending an intensity in the dialogue and a more openness to regular communication.
Mr. Ambassador.
But yes. The two objects that we would want to communicate on are first, terrorism and any information that might indicate that plots against the United States were being launched, from or being hatched in Afghanistan by Al-Qaeda, for instance, or the Islamic State. And secondly, the well-being of the Afghan people, which we want to advance.
Mr. Ambassador, do you think that still some groups from Afghanistan or some individuals from inside Afghanistan pose a threat to the United States of America?
Well, there are a number of groups in Afghanistan that are known to be extremists that conduct terrorism attacks. Not all of them against the United States. There are a variety of groups that are focused elsewhere, on Pakistan, on Kashmir, that are operating from Afghanistan. But there are groups that have a history of attacks on Americans too, which include Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State.
Mr. Ambassador, if the United States itself feel a very great threat for its security from Afghanistan, what do you think, what will be the options for the United States to opt?
Well, we'll take unilateral action if we have to, but the Taliban has already committed to prevent attacks on the United States in its agreement with the U.S. that led to the U.S. withdrawal. So we would, in first instance, look to the Taliban to deal with it.
And do you think that the Taliban could keep their words as they promised back in 2020 and Doha agreement?
I think we should test them. I think we should tell them we expect them to keep their word. I think we should work with them to help them keep their word. I don't know whether they'll keep their word, but it's worth trying.
Right, but it's been almost 10 months for them. They're ruling the country. They're, in these 10 months, they might have showed some flexibility, or you might have some idea about this, whether they should or they kept their words or not.
Well, I don't think we have any information indicating that there are, that Al-Qaeda or Islamic State are plotting attacks on the United States. I'm not privy to U.S. intelligence, but as far as I know, we have not detected any plots at this point against the United States being mounted from Afghanistan.
But U.S. generals, they always express their concerns of a very imminent threat from Afghanistan. Do you think such things will happen, or any threat will happen anytime soon from the Afghan soil against the United States or its allies?
Well, I think we see the possibility of threats. We don't yet see a specific threat. If we saw a specific threat, we would do something about it.
And that will be, what will be that option? I mean, specific military option or something else?
Yeah, the first option is to have the Taliban deal with it. But if they won't deal with it, then we'll have to do it ourselves.
Mr. Ambassador, let's have a glance on the Doha Agreement. Now the general concept is that the Doha Agreement is just down. It's zero. It's not anymore. Do you think your recommendations to the United States government, like engaging with the Taliban, will revitalize the Doha Agreement once again?
I don't know that the Doha Agreement is not in force. I think the U.S. and the Taliban both believe that those commitments are valid. After all, we performed our part of that agreement. We expect the Taliban to do theirs. We withdrew as per that agreement, and we expect them to continue to do what they promised.
So you expect them, that do you think that they will, as they're ruling the country, they literally have the power in the country, or they're ruling, will they get back to the table and restart renegotiation with the Afghan ex-officials to restart, to establish a broad-based government in Afghanistan?
Probably not.
And do you think that the United States can make them get back to the negotiation table if they want to engage with the Taliban?
Well, I don't think we can rate them. I think we can continue to urge them to do so.
Mr. Ambassador,
The Taliban will argue that they tried and failed because the Afghan government at the time didn't engage seriously. So Unfortunately, the Doha Agreement.
Mr. Ambassador, the general concept is that the international community wants the Taliban government to make a broad-based government in Afghanistan. But there is a very ambiguous definition of broad-based government. Do you have any specific definition of broad-based? What do you mean by inclusive government in Afghanistan?
Well, I think, the proposition is fairly simple. There are political and ethnic groups and interests in Afghanistan. There are leaders. It's pretty easy to think people who could be included in the government would represent constituencies other than the Taliban. I don't think it's difficult to think of a more broadly based government. In fact, it's hard to think of a more narrowly based government than the one that you have now. But we're not proposing any particular arrangement. We would just like to see a government that was more inclusive and policies that were more in line with international norms.
Right, Mr. Ambassador, that's what they claim, that they say that they have a very broad government here. There are present different ethnicities, there are different tribes, and all those are in the government right now. So what they say is that why the international community is asking them to make a broad base, because they already have one.
Well, they may be broadly based in an ethnic sense. I don't think they're broadly based in an economic or political sense. There are for instance, the urban population, which has grown substantially in Afghanistan, is not represented. The government is mostly from rural areas where the Taliban has operated for the last 20 years. There are elements of the government who would like to see more liberal policies with respect to the role of women. They're not represented. In fact, women aren't represented at all, which is half the country.
Right, Ms. Ambassador, as per your research, U.S. has four main interests in Afghanistan, which is clearly mentioned: counterterrorism, rights of minorities and women in Afghanistan, inclusive and broad-based government, and maintaining some of the gain of the last 20 years. My question is, how can the U.S. engage with the Taliban where schools are still remain closed for girls for secondary level? How can they want to engage? It's a interest of the United States.
Well, I think engagement is a spectrum from having more meetings to more meaningful interaction. But we suggested that they start by having American officials visit Afghanistan more frequently. Not have all our meetings in Doha, but have meetings in Kabul and have regular discussions. We listen to the Taliban and consider their position and things they wanted, and they would listen to us, and we might progress. Engagement is a process.
Right.
It's not a policy. It's a process, and it's a fairly simple process with a lot of different permutations, a lot of different ways it could develop if it proves productive.
Right, Mr. Ambassador, will the United States be satisfied with the girls returning to schools and basic level of women participation in the workforce?
What do you mean? We seek that. Do you mean Is that, would that be satisfactory? And we wouldn't have any more interest in
Because human rights is one of the interests of the United States. If the schools are remained closed for girls, if women are sidelined from the workforce, yeah. then how can the United States will engage with the Taliban?
Well, we, yes, I mean, that would be one of the main objectives of the engagement, would be that. I don't think engagement, I mean, you have to compare engagement to the opposite policies of isolation or opposition.
And do you think, sir, if the current de facto government is sidelined or isolated, it will lead to the civil war in Afghanistan?
Well, we're certainly not promoting a civil war. We don't want to see a civil war. I don't see, at this point, the signs that one is imminent, but given Afghanistan's history, it's possible. It would depend largely on whether any of the neighboring states see an interest in supporting such a development.
And Mr. Ambassador, Rand has suggested three options to the United States government to engage with the Taliban, with the current government. My question is that, has Rand proposed anything or an option to the Taliban as well?
Well, no. I mean, Rand has issued a study and examined this. It's as much a proposal to the Taliban as to the U.S. government. It's a comment on U.S. policy, and we hope that the Taliban read it as well. And if they agree, that they signal that they agree.
Right, Mr. Ambassador. There is a growing concern in Afghanistan is the frozen assets of the Central Bank of the of Afghanistan back in the United States. How exacerbated that, the situation in Afghanistan? And what's your recommendation to the United States?
Well, we didn't deal with that in any detail. I think it's unfortunate that the situation developed as it has. The use of those funds has become embroiled in U.S. legal cases, which limits our government's flexibility in their use. I think the government intends that at least some of those funds be used to relieve the food situation in Afghanistan and be used for the well-being of the Afghan people. But I'm not... We didn't really deal with that, just in other than to note that that it was one of the elements that was moving the U.S. in the direction of an isolation strategy rather than an engaged strategy.
Right, Mr. Ambassador. Somewhere in your research, you have mentioned that so long I'm just quote unquote so long as the resources remain frozen, the issue will remain a major concern for the Taliban. And will be an obstacle to engagement. How?
Yes. Yes, exactly.
And do you have anything to add with this? Any details?
No. No, I think that says it.
Right. Mr. James Dobbins, former U.S. envoy to Afghanistan and Pakistan, and a senior and distinguished chair in diplomacy and security at the Rand Corporation. Thank you so much for your time in joining us. I really appreciate that.
Thank you. Anytime.
Thank you so much.